coming to Conversations in Conflict series at PARCC. Today we have Professor Matt Eber from the Geography Department here at Maxwell, and his specialties include political economy, historical geography, energy and capitalism, oil resource governance, and social theory. And it looks like you just had a new book out called Lifeblood, Oil, Freedom, and the Forces of Capital. And I know we're all really excited, especially from your title, what you're going to talk about today. So I will give you the floor.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for inviting me. I think Catherine was the first one to ask me to do this, and I was a little concerned because I wasn't sure it fit into the conversations on conflict. But obviously, I think we can agree that environmental issues and climate change in particular is a big emerging conflict for the 21st century. So I put this concept of, I'm now unclear how to actually say it. I say Anthropocene, but I've heard a lot of people say Anthropocene. So I'll say Anthropocene. I put this concept up here. It's a kind of big idea that's gathered a lot of attention. I thought it might help bring people to this room. the idea that literally we're entering a new era of geological time where the fundamental force on the planet is human beings itself, the anthropart, and that we have become a geological force shaping the planet. And here's one of these classic things you can show, or I show my students, that, you know, starting, people date the Anthropocene with the Industrial Revolution in 1800, but you see this, what they call the Great Acceleration, starting in about 1945, post-World War II, this kind of explosion in all these variables, one of which you can see in the second row there, fertilizer consumption, which is what I'll be talking about later. But what this illustrates with this concept of the Anthropocene is this dramatic impact that human beings are having on the planet as a whole. And obviously climate change, and particularly energy consumption, burning fossil fuels to generate climate change, is one of the big things people are concerned about. So I thought, with some risk, I'd start off today by asking you all, when you think about particularly energy consumption, what types of things pop into your mind?
Oil.
Okay. What about oil? Yeah?
Coal.
So those are the resources we consume. What about particular acts of energy consumption? What do you kind of imagine?
Transportation.
So driving in your car. Mm-hmm. What else? Compact fluorescent light bulbs. So those are much more energy efficient. You can put them in your home and in your lamps and save money and save energy, save the environment. So these are all good things. Anything else?
Power generation.
So anything, whenever we flip the switch or I'm harnessing this probably not so energy efficient television, whatever this thing is, it's linked to ultimately a site of power generation, whether it's hydroelectric or coal-fired power plants or natural gas-fired power plants. So ultimately our individual acts of electricity consumption are linked to those sites. But what I wanted to do with that exercise is kind of illustrate that when we think about energy consumption, we most often think about our own kind of individual consumer types of interactions with energy, driving cars, turning on light bulbs, working on electronic devices. And that actually links to a lot of social critics have pointed out the problems with only, when we think about environmental policy and solutions, there's really a lot of problems with only focusing on individual consumer choices, and that really distracts us from the more massive and systemic changes we need to make to confront climate change and other environmental problems we might have. What I want to talk about today is that if we focus on energy and we're only looking at individual acts of consumption, we're not even looking at the main problem. There's an incredibly uneven geography of energy consumption, and that is there's actually an unequal responsibility for emissions. And a lot of times our politics and policy discussions don't take this into account. So by that, I'm trying to lead up to what I'm going to talk about today, which is the main consumer of energy in our economy, this is the U.S., is the industrial sector. So this is stuff like automobile manufacturing, steel factories, weapons production, refineries. These are the kind of the industrial base of the economy churning out lots of different products. So it is not only the largest consumer, it is by a pretty wide margin, the largest source of greenhouse gas emissions. And this kind of dichotomy and responsibility becomes even more stark when we look at the global level, where over 50% of energy consumption is coming out of the industrial sector. Can anyone think, why would it be way more dramatic at the global level and compared to the U.S.?
China.
In a word. I mean, and it's not just China. We have, essentially, we've seen over the last, really, 50 years, this kind of globalization of manufacturing and industrial production. But China is a huge part of that.
And India.
Yeah. Mexico and other, you know, South Korea and East Asia, all over. So when we look globally, it's really very clear that if we're concerned about energy and climate change, we really need to focus on the industrial sector. So why don't we pay much attention to the industrial sector when we think about changing our energy system and our climate change? So that's kind of the basic question I'm dealing with. And if you'll indulge me here, I hope I don't lose the room with this slide, but I actually come from a perspective that uses Marx's critique of capitalism to help us understand the politics of capitalism. And I actually think that has some relevance for explaining why we don't look at the industrial sector. So bear with me here. If you look at Marx's most famous work, which is called Capital Volume 1, his whole goal in that book is to explain this formula, which he calls the formula for capital, where businesses and enterprises, they have money to start off at the day, they invest that money into workers and means of production, which are commodities, see? And then they come out of that process with more money. We call that profit. That's the whole basis of the book, is where does that extra money come from? Because he goes through all this sort of exercises. If you follow political economic theory, you know, exchange in the market is supposed to be about equivalence, right? So they're supposed to always be equal, the commodities you're exchanging. So how do we explain the fact that these capitalists come out with more money at the end of the day? Where does this profit come from? And a lot of the political economists of his day would only focus on the realm of market exchange to try to discover that. But Marx had a different idea, and he said, let us, in the company with the owner of money and the owner of labor power, leave this noisy sphere of the market where everything takes place on the surface and in full view of everyone, and follow them into what he calls the hidden abode of production, on whose threshold there hangs a notice, no admittance except on business. So again, going to a factory gate, again, even if today we're concerned about energy consumption of industrial factories, a lot of journalists and researchers, like, you can't just go in and come into a factory to examine these things. It's private property. It's sort of this zone of our economy that's not open for view. It's really hidden from us, and that's why he called it a hidden abode. And of course, in his book, he kind of goes on to show, if we go into the factories, we discover where that extra value is coming from. And big surprise, it's coming from exploiting workers and basically not paying the workers the full amount of the value they're producing for the capitalists. And that's what he calls exploitation, and that becomes the basis for capital accumulation. So enough, that's the end of my Marx stuff. We're concerned with a different formula, not MC M prime, but this formula of basically when we take hydrocarbon molecules, expose them to oxygen and heat and chemical processes to create carbon dioxide emissions and other greenhouse gas emissions. But similar to classical political economists in Marx's day, most attention to the problem of climate change only focuses on this noisy sphere of market exchange and consumption, like we kind of illustrated at the beginning today. That is, we only really look at the surface of society, where we can see things in consumer practices and consumer exchange and markets where we actually buy and consume stuff, the cars, the households, even land use patterns. So we only focus on exchange. And we assume the problem is then getting the prices right in that realm of exchange. So if we're emitting too much carbon, we need to set a price for carbon. If we want to lower emissions, we focus on individual consumer behaviors in the market to buy less energy-intensive cars, buy hybrids, energy-efficient light bulbs, so forth. So what I want to suggest today is to actually understand the origins of our carbon problem. We need to leave this noisy sphere and venture into the hidden abodes of industrial production. And I think when we go there, we actually, I would argue, confront really the material foundations of a lot of our carbon-based society that we don't often see on the surface of our lives, actually. So consider cities are hugely built with steel and concrete. But when cities and mayors in particular consider their carbon footprint, they don't often take into account the energy and emissions it requires to build those cities with cement and concrete and steel. It's estimated that the cement industry alone is responsible for 5% of global carbon emissions. Steel industry, which is, talk about China, almost all of it is in China now. It consumes a stunning 15% of global coal consumption and is responsible for 7% of global emissions. So those two industries were already up to 12% of global emissions. But I'm kind of a firm believer that these problems are inherently political in nature and not necessarily technical. What I want to talk about today is how do we think politically about the ecological impacts of the industrial sector? And for this, I'm really drawing on a field that comes out of industrial ecology, which looks at industrial flows of materials. In particular, they do something what is called input-output analysis, to kind of trace the flows of inputs to an industrial process and the outputs. But these scholars really don't think about the politics of these flows. They really are interested in kind of the thermodynamics and the materiality of the flows, but not much the politics. So what happens when we examine the political and social factors that shape these inputs and outputs? So in this talk, I'm going to show the possibilities of this approach through a case study on another really energy-intensive sector, the production of ammonia, or 80% of which becomes nitrogen-based fertilizer. So first, I want to give some background on nitrogen that might help contextualize this. This is 1898. This British scholar, Sir William Crookes, warned that the scarcity of nitrogen fertilizer meant a catastrophic there's going to be basically starvation for the wheat eaters, and I think he meant Europeans by that. The world supply of nitrogen fertilizers at the time was mainly from natural sources like manure, cover crops, and increasingly this kind of really crazy global scramble for saltpeter and nitrates and guano in the fields of Chile and Peru, where there were these natural sort of deposits of nitrogen-rich material. But Crookes was aware that the air, the atmosphere, actually contains nearly an inexhaustible supply of nitrogen. 78% of the air around us is actually nitrogen. But one of the problems is one of the key problems of actually capitalist production is time. He suggested the store of nitrogen in the atmosphere is practically unlimited, but it is fixed, meaning usable by plants, and rendered assemblable by plants by cosmic processes of extreme slowness. So we knew there's all this nitrogen up there, but there's no way to harness it or fix it in ways that plants can use. So he made clear that the key to avoiding mass starvation and civilizational collapse was a chemical process to fix this atmospheric nitrogen in rapid fashion. And he suggested it is the chemist who must come to the rescue of threatened communities. It is through the laboratory that starvation will be turned into. So, like many scarcity problems before and after, this wheat problem was solved through a technical fix, and this is what we call chemical synthesis of ammonia, the famous Haber-Bosch process, which was developed in Germany and right before World War I, to actually chemically fix nitrogen in factories, getting nitrogen from the air to combine with hydrogen molecules. So taking the nitrogen from the air, combining it with hydrogen molecules, submitting these things to tremendous heat and pressure, and turning it into NH3, which is ammonia, which is actually stuff you can put on plants and it will help them grow. But it became clear to produce this ammonia at a profitable scale, you needed this massive kind of classic chemical factory with networks, pipes, boilers, reaction vessels, and that's sort of what became a big part of the chemical industry the ammonia industry and nitrogen fertilizer production. Also, explosives production, which is another important use of nitrogen that I won't talk a lot about, but there's a lot to say about it. So, examining from this political industrial ecology perspective allows us to understand that this metabolism of ammonia production is not just a material throughput of inputs and outputs, but a highly politicized process of resource control and massive pollution. So I'm going to go through two inputs, a brief discussion of the actual metabolism, and then two outputs. So first, we get this nitrogen from the atmosphere. At first glance, it would appear that this is not really that political of an issue. Air appears to be an inexhaustible resource. This is a quote from the U.S. Geological Survey report on ammonia. 78% of the air is nitrogen, so why not make use of it? But on deeper inspection, I think this consumption of air reveals one of the biggest problems of the ways in which capitalism values, or in this case doesn't value, natural processes. The nitrogen industry appropriates this air for free. It treats this air, or the atmosphere as a whole, as a kind of giant commons that it can just sort of draw on. And by doing so, it takes for granted and does not need to price all the kind of natural and biogeochemical processes that underlie the continued existence of air. This will actually matter a lot later, but let me just say now that this is a big problem, that industry is able to freely appropriate these natural conditions, and reveals the problem that capitalism doesn't really value much of what exists in the natural world, whether it's wetlands or nutrient cycles in soils or atmospheric processes. Okay, moving right along. We often think oil, we think our food system is really reliant on oil, right? And that's true. We use lots of oil to make pesticides and to fire up diesel-powered tractors. But what I'm going to talk a lot about today is that our food system, and particularly the fertilizer system, is almost entirely dependent on natural gas. This is a ad from the early 50s. Lion Chemical Company sort of boasting about their ability to turn natural gas into food fiber and feed, which became the sort of the center of our industrial food system. So how does this work? You might just think natural gas is required because the process is energy intensive, and you're right. But some natural gas is used to boil water and generate heat for lots of processes in the facility. Wait, backing up one side, I just wanted to point out, we often think natural gas consumption is just to heat our homes and to power electricity, but again, here we are, the industrial sector, 34, the highest percentage of use of natural gas. It's not just for fertilizer, it's for all manner of chemicals and other forms of industrial production. So getting back, so we think, okay, fertilizers use natural gas, they must just use it to burn natural gas to generate heat, right? So what I want to point out is that the main source of natural gas is actually to create that hydrogen there. They take methane, natural gas, which is CH4, and they break off the C and through reactions to get the H. And so therefore, natural gas is most importantly, and two-thirds of the natural gas that the fertilizer industry uses is as a feedstock, as a material feedstock for producing ammonia.
What is ammonia?
NH3. I'm not a chemist, but the two is to balance the equation or something. We often think of energy resources purely burning it for fuel, but we use a lot of these resources as feedstocks. So the plant I visited in Louisiana consumes an incredible amount of natural gas. It's estimated that this single factory consumes 10% of Louisiana's entire natural gas consumption. So a single fertilizer factory, 10% of Louisiana's natural gas. All in all, the numbers are globally pretty staggering. Ammonia production consumes about 17% of the energy in the entire chemical sector, and 2-3% of global energy demand. Unlike nitrogen, which it gets for free, natural gas represents 80-90% of the cost of producing ammonia for these factories. The plant manager I visited at the facility in Louisiana joked that the nitrogen industry has three main components: gas, gas, and gas. But so part of my still not answered research question for this project is, how has the nitrogen industry affected the politics of natural gas historically? I'm still trying to figure that out. But I just want to talk about how they're shaping it now in current times, and how they've become a highly vocal player in the politics of natural gas today, which really means they've been a vocal player in the politics of fracking. This is a leading company, what they put in one of their reports: the U.S. energy sector's ingenuity in unlocking vast quantities of natural gas from shale makes America the right place to invest. Abundant shale gas means reliable supply of United States sourced nitrogen fertilizer for decades to come. So the fertilizer industry is a huge beneficiary of this boom and now really glut of cheap natural gas in our economy. And you're seeing fertilizer plants now expanding, like the one I'm visiting in Louisiana, but also new ones are being constructed in places like Iowa and so forth. So how have they inserted themselves, the fertilizer industry, into the politics of natural gas? So this is just looking at the Fertilizer Institute's webpage, and you see how they try to position how important natural gas is to food security and feeding the world, as they say. But they're also really kind of neatly involved in, or deeply involved in, kind of everyday legislation that might shift demand for natural gas and raise the prices. So in this particular legislation, there was an effort by the government to kind of try to spur a shift of our transportation sector towards natural gas-fired trucks and cars and government vehicles and whatever. And of course, the fertilizer industry is very worried about this, because if the government's sort of investing in a shift towards natural gas, it raises demand and it raises prices. So they're not in favor in this. And of course, they want to, at this point, produce this critique: we believe that the market, not the federal government, should be determining the price of natural gas. But actually, you think right now they're free market believers, but that's only when the market results in low prices. So if the market, you would think also market believers believe very much in free trade and the free exporting and importing of materials, but this is where the fertilizer industry betrays its free market views, because it's largely opposed to the export of natural gas in the form of liquefied natural gas, which, because of this cheap glut we have right now, everyone, who do you think is most interested in exporting natural gas right now?
The natural gas industry.
They are suffering with these low prices, and they know to get high prices, they need to reach a wider market and get this stuff out of. And it's funny, because they sold us on fracking because it was domestic and it was energy security, and now they just want to export it. So, the chemical industry as a whole that uses tons of natural gas is very kind of, sometimes Dow doesn't say we are full on opposed to exports, but they say we want kind of a measured and balanced approach to exports. But they're very much concerned about LNG exports, again, and a free market, free trade person would believe we should allow this, but really the State Department is what is restricting our ability to approve these LNG exports and so forth.
I always thought they believed in corporate welfare.
I think, you know, that's the stuff
not
where...
Not free market.
Yeah, right. I mean, that's behind the free market kind of perspective that is often convenient to talk about. So, and the fertilizer instance, this is kind of a very obscure example, but this is from a critique of a report that the government, the Department of Energy commissioned, which showed that allowing LNG exports would be a net benefit for the economy as a whole. And so the Fertilizer Institute comes out and says, you have underestimated the value of the fertilizer industry for jobs and for food security and all this stuff. So again, this is probably obvious by now, but if we consider the politics of fracking, we don't often think about these voices, these industrial consumers. But it's ironically these industrial consumers, not natural gas producers, who have been the largest beneficiaries of the shale gas boom. And this massive expansion we're seeing right now of petrochemical plants and fertilizer plants throughout Louisiana, Texas, and even places like Iowa, And some have hoped Pittsburgh. They're trying to build this like ethane cracker outside of Pittsburgh. This massive expansion of natural gas-based chemical production will lock in decades of carbon-intensive and environmentally damaging forms of chemical production. But we don't talk about it enough when we talk about the politics of fracking. Okay, in between inputs and outputs is, better go quickly, is the metabolism itself of these actual facilities. And I could talk about this forever, but very briefly. I just want to talk about, a lot of people in my field talk about the politics of land and struggles over land. It's worth pointing out that these facilities require huge access to land. The plant I studied sits on 1,400 acres, which is a massive swath of territory. But interestingly, it acquired this land from a former sugar plantation owner. And this is kind of the geography of sugar plantations along the Mississippi River. That it's really historic. You know, they'd set up these massive plantations right on the river. And I actually was over spring break down in Louisiana, and I was able to track down the daughter of the person who sold his land to the chemical company I'm studying. And she was actually, it was a very fascinating conversation. She was horrified that her daddy, as she called him, sold this land to the chemical industry. She saw the chemical industry as dirty and evil, she said. And she said it really sullied what she conceded might be an overly romantic view of the plantation culture and plantation life. But what is clear is that the chemical industry in what is now called Cancer Alley in this area between Baton Rouge and New Orleans, it really was, this chemical industry was made possible by this certain regime of plantation capitalism. This system that created immense wealth. The daughter continually said that when she was growing up, we didn't have a care in the world. And she was shocked to discover that not everyone had a daddy that could buy them their first house, which she enjoyed. Of course, it's probably overly obvious, but the wealth was generated on the backs of slaves and later low-paid wage and sharecropper African-American farmhands. But the large-scale nature of plantations meant that chemical companies could acquire these huge tracts of land relatively cheaply. Moving on, ammonia plants are kind of interesting in this Cancer Alley region. They have not really attracted much environmental activist attention. This is a really epic center of what people call environmental justice struggles. Low-income communities, often of color, have fought back against toxic pollution. But ammonia plants don't produce the kind of carcinogenic outputs that concern most communities, like benzene and other really highly toxic and leading to long-term health problems. What they do produce are leaks of ammonia almost on a regular basis into the air and water, which leads to a kind of horrible, if you've ever smelled ammonia, it's not a nice stench, and it sort of surrounds the community. A local chemist told me it generates a feeling of kind of smothering or suffocating, but the impacts are actually acute and short-term, and the health impacts are not these kind of long-term cancerous types of things. So kind of interesting, I'm kind of interested how this massive facilities that consume so much and emit so much are actually not that much of an object of political activism locally. Okay, I'm gonna just move right along. Output number one is obvious, and again, the whole talk could be about this. The output is ammonia, and 80% or so of ammonia that we produce is used for fertilizer. So the companies are continually trying to legitimate their political existence through a focus on feeding the world and a focus on increasing population and how they're going to always innovate these technologies that allow us to produce more food. There's much to kind of criticize about these narratives. Much of our food hunger problem is due to distribution, not really due to a lack of food per se. But this is how the fertilizer industry from the start has always been able to legitimize. This is actually for sulfur fertilizer, so it's not so relevant. But Shell and other companies are consistently trying to say, look, we're helping feed the world by expanding these technologies around the world. Ammonia has become kind of the core of our industrial agricultural systems. It's really applied to corn, soy, wheat crops, which is the basis of our cheap meat and processed foods economy, and also increasingly our transportation sector, which is 40% of our corn crop now goes into our gasoline tanks, which is crazy. And all this fertilizer application has horrible runoff problems. So the nitrogen you apply to the crops, it runs off into the rivers. And we had recently a toxic algae bloom from this, from eutrophication of a fertilizer runoff that contaminated the water supply of Toledo. We probably may have heard of the massive dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico, which is from nitrogen runoff from like the Corn Belt in Iowa and other Midwestern states. It goes into the Mississippi River, and eutrophication sort of kills off the area right at the mouth of the river in the Gulf of Mexico. So ironically, Louisiana produces huge amounts of ammonia, ships it upriver to Iowa where they apply it to the corn, and then lose 75% of that ammonia into the river, comes back downriver, kills off the Gulf of Mexico. One thing I found interesting when the industry tries to talk about their environmental benefits, they generally only focus on application of fertilizer. A lot of the concern about the fertilizer industry is because these runoff issues and the water contamination from farms, which is a big issue. But what I find interesting is there's almost no mention of the industrial production of ammonia and the impacts there. So again, we're kind of only looking at the surface of when people are consuming fertilizer and applying it when we even talk about environmental impacts.
I have a question.
Yeah.
The ammonia that comes off the runoff,
yeah,
can that be recaptured?
Well, that's kind of all these things, like these nutrient stewardship programs and all their programs. I went to an industry conference. All they're talking about is finding out ways to have farmers kind of be able to have the plants uptake more of the nitrogen, more so that the efficiency of uptake to be higher. And they have all these kind of different seeds and hybrid varieties. They think this will uptake more. So that's been the goal. Once it's run off, recapturing it becomes difficult because it kind of circulates broadly in the water system. Okay, last output. So this is when I visited, I got a tour of this facility. I was lucky to get beyond the hidden abode. And I think this is the emissions of carbon dioxide. I'm looking at my photos, I'm pretty sure, but they have so many vents and I can't really remember which one is the carbon dioxide vent, but it looks kind of like no big deal, right? It's just, it doesn't look like the center of the facility, but this is an immense problem. So I want to kind of explain, a lot of these emissions are what are called process-based. That is, it's not simply from burning fuel, burning natural gas that creates combustion-based emissions, that actually when they take that CH4, that natural gas to create hydrogen there, which is the basis of ammonia synthesis, they combine it with water, and what comes out of that process is CO2. And so that's a huge amount of their emissions are these process-based emissions. They actually use some of that CO2 as an input to the production of urea, which is another fertilizer, but then the EPA doesn't let them count that as, because when you apply the urea, it releases the CO2. So they like to say, hey, we are using these, we're very efficient industrial users of CO2, but ultimately that CO2 will end up in the atmosphere anyway. So obviously, this is a big target of climate regulation. And here we get back to the problem of the industry's treating natural processes as free gifts. Remember, they're appropriating the air for free, but they're also dumping into the air for free, with no regard to the disruption of these larger atmospheric processes that have made our climate stable for so many thousands of years. And they are very much aware that these practices are increasingly politicized, so they're trying to kind of do things to look better from a carbon perspective. So I'm not allowed to tell you what company I'm studying because IRB is worried I'd hurt their feelings. So the nitrogen company I'm studying recently sold $600,000 worth of carbon credits to actually an American automobile manufacturer, and they donated the proceeds to the National Future Farmers of America to say, look, we're selling carbon credits, we're funding agriculture to feed the world again.
How did they sell carbon credits?
Yeah, I'll get okay. There. This is a PR move. They know these practices are under political scrutiny. The fertilizer industry alone accounts for between 3% and 5% of global emissions, a lot of it in China, actually. So the company generated carbon credits by voluntarily implementing nitrous oxide technologies to reduce nitrous oxide emissions, which are another greenhouse gas. So they're able to produce 3.1 million metric tons of equivalent carbon dioxide. So they take the nitrogen oxide emissions and they do a formula to say how much would this equivalent in carbon terms. But they're only focusing on nitrous oxide. And they've only done these programs at two of the seven facilities that they run. And most importantly, the focus on nitrous oxide is kind of political bait and switch, because nitrous oxide emissions are one thing, but their main footprint is carbon dioxide. So they're not doing anything about carbon dioxide. At the plant I study, 77% of their emissions are carbon dioxide, not nitrous oxide. So again, this looks good, but it doesn't really confront the problem. So obviously, the Fertilizer Institute opposes Obama's new plan to regulate greenhouse gas emissions through the Clean Air Act. And again, they're very concerned here because his plan is really to shift our electric sector to natural gas. And that will lead to more natural gas consumption, higher prices for the fertilizer industry. So I need to wrap up. So stunningly, the plant I visited, this is another slide, which is from a presentation by the Fertilizer Institute, which just shows how opposed they are to any form of carbon regulation, because it's going to increase their cost to have to actually purchase offset emissions. It's going to increase their electricity costs, which are also sizable. It's going to, again, lead to fuel switching, which they're really concerned about. But also, when I've talked to plant officials, they were most upset about this. If the U.S. implements this climate legislation, it's going to put us at a competitive disadvantage against China and other carbon-intensive ammonia producers. And that's just not fair in this global market economy. So this is a huge deal. The facility I visited in Louisiana is the number one emitter of greenhouse gases in the entire chemical sector of the United States, the whole United States. It's number three in Louisiana, only behind a couple coal-fired power plants. So these are sizable carbon footprints from these types of facilities. So in order to continue those incredible carbon footprints, you know they're going to be highly involved in the politics of climate change. Okay, so that's the end of the inputs and outputs. I did want to do one more thing. So you look, 6.9 million CO2. So coming back to kind of where I started, let's look at that in comparison to per capita metric tons of emissions. So that's just, if we took all the emissions in the country and divided it by population, where are we? So If this particular industry emits 6.9 million per year, we can look at some countries, and this just shows the unbelievable inequality between countries in terms of carbon responsibility. So 6.9 million versus, 0.2 in Tanzania. The United States down there, it's very high. What's that?
They're like the Ukraine.
Who's like the Ukraine? No.
Sorry, I'm confused.
This is 6.6, the Ukraine 6.6 metric tons per capita.
Uh-huh.
The facility I study is 6.9 million metric tons. So we're talking, just again, a crazy order of magnitude. Does anyone see a really high one on that list?
Yeah, Trinidad, Tobago.
Massive natural gas supplies in Trinidad, Tobago, and massive ammonia production.
Wow.
Our largest imports of nitrogen and ammonia come from Trinidad and Tobago. So not a lot of people in Trinidad and Tobago, but huge energy consumption to produce ammonia. Okay, so to conclude, I'm early enough in this project where I don't have a conclusion. I have questions. And the questions I'm thinking about are really why, when we think about possible changes to nature side of religion, why do we only imagine our own individual behavior changes? Why don't we even think or talk about these more massive and systemic industrial forms? And how do industrial companies actually displace a lot of the political attention away from production and towards, again, what Marx called this noisy sphere of consumption? And what would politicizing the industrial sector look like? How can we actually create a politics that says that we should have some democratic input on how our food system is fertilized, on how what types of chemicals are necessary for a society we want to live in? These types of questions. Because obviously now we live in a world where this sector is completely controlled by private corporations that care about profit. So if we want to politicize, that means we want to actually have democracy to make decisions on how that sector is run. So that's where I'll end. Thank you very much. I have some acknowledgments.
Reference the Fertilizer Institute quite frequently. I was wondering how central that is as a lobbying or business advocacy kind of organization in the political process. Is that, are they making donations? Are they just running lobbyists? What do they actually do?
They're the biggest sort of fertilizer advocacy organization in the United States. There are bigger ones sort of globally.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them are based in Europe. But in the U.S., they're based in D.C. I'm still, again, early on, I haven't been able to do much tracing to see how much power money-wise they have on the process, which is, when I asked a lot of industry officials, they kind of act like, oh, well, there's already other people lobbying on behalf of us, so we don't need to do much of it ourselves. What I'm kind of interested in is, we always hear about the huge lobbying power of the oil and gas industry. But they're actually kind of at odds with the fertilizer industry because they want high prices, the fertilizer industry wants low prices. So when it comes down to it, you might have lobbyists sort of fighting each other on those perspectives. And how do those battles get waged and who wins? But I need to learn more about that.
There's also, this is kind of far-fetched, but there is an opportunity to reduce demand by changing farming practices, moving away from corporate farming to the rotational crops that often don't need any fertilizer at all.
Yeah. My wife's a small farmer.
Oh, really?
And so she teaches me about cover cropping and all these. And what's exciting about her methods is she's able to farm what's called intensively. On a little amount of land, she's able to grow a huge amount of, she's growing like vegetables. She's not growing monocultured corn or anything like that. But that again is, we talk about food issues and a lot of people want more kind of democracy in shaping how our food system is run from the ground up, because now we have a kind of food policy that subsidizes cheap industrial food production using a lot of this stuff.
And I thought it was interesting that their messages present them as the good guys, they're feeding the world. How can you be against that?
Yeah, what cost?
Yeah. Well, that doesn't come up. They're the good guys. Just like BP, all those commercials.
Yeah.
And they're creating jobs. And
supporting
the local economy. And
I was just down in Louisiana, and on this phone that has location-based services and like geospatial data, I sort of noticed when I go on the Twitter app, I started to see BP-sponsored ads all throughout my Twitter feed because I was in Louisiana, where obviously people are kind of upset with them. So, it was kind of creepy. It's like, but feeding the world is the chemical fertilizer. I mean, from the very start, that's what they say over and over again. When I went to an industry conference in November, I can't tell you how many times that was said. It was just sort of ad nauseum. We feed the world.
They'd be that interested in feeding the world if it weren't a
profit. Right. And, they also feed our gasoline tanks, which I keep for, it's like if the corn that uses nitrogen fertilizer is being thrown into cars, it's not even feeding anyone. So.
Are these plants large employment job producers?
Yeah, actually I was going to talk about that and was running out of time, so I skipped over it. In the town I visited, it's a small, poor town in Louisiana of like 7,000 people, and there's 400 people employed at the plant. And when I tried to talk to local residents about, even when I said just these sort of positive and negative impacts of the plant, people just froze up and said no comment. And it's a very company town, and it's basically the only economic game in town, so there's not much local criticism you can at least get people to admit or say out loud.
I just want to, the questions that you raised at the end, you know, why, when we think of possible the nature relations, we only imagine individual behavioral change, or the other one too, but I guess the question is, what, like, do you have, how are you drawing that conclusion? Do you have data that in fact suggests that we only imagine individual behavioral change? In the politics of climate change, I mean, I'm not sure that that
imagination.
You know, I mean, I think it's
possibly
true, but I'm not convinced that it's overwhelmingly true.
Yeah, I don't have data on that question. I tried at the beginning to kind of survey the audience and see what people said to kind of set up a foil.
Yeah.
But in engagements with my students and just. When I talk about environmental politics, this is what I see coming up again and again. And there's been scholarship on that issue. Again, critiques of individualizing narratives about consumption. There's probably data out there, though.
Yeah, I'm sure there is, and I think it's also, like, you know, there's something about American society, mm-hmm. historically and contemporaneously also, is very individualist oriented. Mm-hmm. And so we tend to think about, but I think it just seems to me that some of those issues surrounding this are actually, you know, would really add something to the research that you're doing to actually think about what it is, because it may not be true in other places, mm-hmm. and other cultures,
yeah.
and what's driving that,
yeah.
you know, it, yes, the industry does try to displace ecological political attention, but they're effective because we're pre-set to respond in that way,
yeah.
think about it in that way, and I think that would add to what you're trying to do here.
Mm-hmm. They also have a larger megaphone.
They do.
It's an interesting thought, because I know I have kids in school, and if you look at their books having to do with ecology from the time they were very little, the whole message is about the individual,
right?
And even as they've gotten older, because they're in high school, they still tend to get these messages about the individual. Now why, whether that's coming out of sort of American individualism or whether it's coming out of, you would have no problem finding government basically says, if each of us,
right.
So where that rhetoric is motivated from is an interesting question, but it's absolutely embedded in our society, our educational system, and our understanding of climate change, right? You'll hear that. If each one of us drove a hybrid, used fluorescent bulbs, had different kinds of toilet, we can go on and on, right? Put in a little solar thing in our house, we'd solve the problem.
This is also a sphere where we think we have some control. And responsibility.
Exactly.
Right.
That's where
here,
kind of sphere of possible change.
That? Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. We don't put industrial sector on the table as a changeable, mm-hmm.
Something
field.
That we have personally impact.
Right.
And that's probably the same.
Right.
Well, but why is an interesting question?
Yeah.
Maybe it is cultural.
So one approach would say, well, ultimately these industrial sectors are rooted in our individual everyday practices, right? So one political proposal would be, well, if individual consumers buy organic food and stop supporting the industrial food system, that will move away from it and it will bankrupt these ammonia factories.
Mm-hmm.
Coming from my perspective, I believe you need a sort of much more sort of larger scale policy to shift that kind of
mm-hmm.
sector on a more systemic, widespread basis, that it's
and
probably not going to happen through simply consumers.
And they have a huge economic advantage.
Yes.
There are a lot of people who don't want to or can't afford to pay a lot more.
Exactly. Especially in this economy.
Basically, you're talking about government regulation, then.
Yeah.
Which, of course, is socialism. So we're against that.
But a lot of people have recently, Naomi Klein's book is basically like, if we want to solve climate change, it's really unfortunate that we live in this period of free market ideology, because the only way we're going to solve this problem is by massive public sector intervention into the market. Precisely because, like I said, the market doesn't price a lot of these natural systems.
It's not an equally weighted or free market.
An alternative to government regulation would be might be more intensive investment by advocates of more environmentally friendly policies into the corporations that are doing the manufacturing so that they can have more influence from the inside.
Mm-hmm. Some people have tried shareholder activism.
I think there are more companies, now at least we hear more about companies that want to do well by doing good, that are socially responsible and environmentally aware.
Up to a point.
Yeah. Right. I said more than we used to.
They have to be profitable, they're not going to exist.
But if you read their website, they're socially responsible and environmentally aware. Yeah.
So I think sometimes there's what people call greenwashing, where companies are saying, look at what we're doing to green ourselves and to be environmental stewards.
Yeah.
But in this case, it's like an example of sort of looking at one thing and distracting from the real massive problem behind it.
PRBS.
I think from my own experience, to answer your third question, what would politicizing the industrial look like? Mm. It seems to me that when people get interested in environmentalism, one of the first things they do is they start recycling. And that sort of leads you down a path, and depending what city you live in, right, you could find a public sector that's more or less well-developed. So, for example, Diana and I went on a tour of the waste management plant, you know, where the waste is treated before it's sunk into the Onondaga Lake. And, you can find composting facilities in different cities. You know, you can find better public transportation in different cities. You can find, more or less, environmentally politicized industrial sectors that have been taken out by the public sphere.
Right.
I guess that kind of leads me to a question about fertilizer, because I know a little bit about hunger in other countries. It's funny that hunger bus is sitting out there right now, trying to educate us about world hunger. But a lot of the programs that I'm familiar with, that people say, well, this is the way to take care of hunger in a certain country, usually involves subsidizing, and correct me if I'm wrong, but the ones that I've read about, in lefty publications, usually involves subsidizing the purchase of fertilizer, right? So I want to know, I thought fertilizer came from poop, and that poop is free, right?
Yeah.
So why, when did people lose the knowledge, or why don't people have the knowledge of composting, at a citywide scale?
Well, they do. Did you hear the NPR story this weekend of what happens to New York City poop, since we're discussing? It was a story basically about the fact that they produce huge quantities and that they had been selling it to Colorado as fertilizer, and it had kind of gone crazy because it was incredibly effective fertilizer.
No.
And that lasted for about 20 years, and then they stopped doing it, and now they use it for landfill. So when I was listening to this, I'm thinking, was there like an activist movement of the fertilizer industry?
Yeah.
Because they were saying in this story that every city's doing this now. So if you go to Home Depot and you buy a bag, it's called Mill something, they said it's Milwaukee poop.
Yeah.
So you're right.
And I want to know why other countries where they supposedly haven't had an agricultural revolution, why don't they have that knowledge? Why?
I don't know.
Well, one thing this chemical stuff does for sure is probably improve yield.
You mean crop yield?
Yep. When compared There are a lot of debates on that, though. Again, like I said, some of the cutting edge, what's called agroecology methods, claim that you can do really high yield intensive agriculture without these inputs. But these inputs do make it easy to grow a lot of this stuff. So that's kind of where they've always been, again, able to legitimate their existences by increasing yields, increasing the amount of food. But it's really a story that's a larger historical story of how farmers kind of transition from fertilizing methods that were really based on free stuff, like stuff within the farm, like poop and like cover cropping methods and yeah, so those were all kind of local knowledge systems and systems that didn't have to pay for, and we saw a transition towards farmers that started to buy fertilizers as commodity inputs, and that started even way earlier than the development of chemical nitrogen, because people were using bone meal and guano from Peru and actually processing it in factories and selling bags of fertilizer to farmers to help improve their soil fertility. And slowly but surely, farmers became convinced that it was more effective to buy their way to soil fertility rather than to do the somewhat labor-intensive and other methods of improving soil fertility.
Well, suppose as farms get corporate and huge, you can't produce this. Or it's very costly.
So would part of the solution then, could part of the solution then, and I mean, I guess this is where my proclivities lean, could it be a free market solution where we put a price on, you know, the price of natural gas goes up, so the price of fertilizer goes up, so all of a sudden it's cheaper to do, you know, manure-based fertilizer than it is to do.
Yeah, I mean, I would, you know, if a carbon tax led to that, I think that's worth trying something like that, yeah, in terms of the narrow options that we are given. But that would very much make it more expensive to do this type of industrial agriculture.
One of the challenges is we're talking about the U.S.
Get to class. I have no idea.
A global issue.
Yes.
Regardless of what we do in this country.
Yes.
Well, I'd like to point out that on their website, the number four, you highlighted how it said, you know, why should we be, you know, we're losing competitive in the global market when other countries are not doing anything with no climate change laws. That's just a flat out lie.
Right.
I mean, there are provinces in China that have a carbon tax, and there are more people than do them. So, I mean, I think we see a lot of that self-serving lie coming from different industries.
Yep. Yeah. That's when I talked to officials about the climate, that's what they kept saying. China
doesn't not doing anything.
It's just this sort of trope.
Yeah.
People don't know anything about Chinese energy policy, carbon and climate policy.
You know something about their pollution problems.
Well, that's the crazy. They are the worst when it comes to ammonia because they use coal to produce their fertilizer, and it's like it makes our industry look really clean in comparison, actually.
That's natural gases, right?
Yeah, clean burning.
Clean energy.
Well, thank you for coming.
Thanks a lot. Thank you all for coming.